Friends, today we are celebrating completion of 2 years of our Friday group. It was initiated in the year of 2015, 10th July. Today we completed those 2 years. Several Friday group meetings was taken place. Nearly 52 meetings were completed. Today, Shri Kapil Sibal is going to give a lecture on GST. Sir, we are very happy. Thank you very much for addressing us. We are highly grateful, even though you have a precious time. A lot of precious time, I can understand, sir. You came all the way to address us. We are really grateful to you. Mr. Sibal is a member of parliament and topmost senior advocate of this country and former cabinet minister of law and justice, HRD and IT ministry. Sir, now you can initiate the debate on GST. Enlighten all of our friends.
Thank you very much. Lovely to be. You want me to stand?
Not that, sir.
No.
Sir, one
lovely,
one
lovely
second.
To be here.
I just died.
What's this? Oh, okay.
Sorry, sir.
Thank you.
Sorry, sir.
You're lovely to be here.
We are also there on YouTube also.
Amidst all of you. Somebody went to a restaurant the other day and ordered a soup. So the waiter asked him, what soup do you want? A clear soup or a GST soup? So she said, I want a clear soup. Well, what is a GST soup? He said, a GST soup is a soup which is not clear. Actually, the goods and services tax is a very revolutionary step that has been taken. And let's not get into the politics of it. It's a revolutionary step because it does away with most taxes. Does away with the excise duty, does away with luxury tax, does away with so many other taxes that used to make the entire system and for the business community entirely complicated. So to that extent, I think that we all must applaud that at last we have something in place. And the objective of a goods and services tax is that all business must come within the tax net. A lot of businesses in India are not within the tax net. So if all businesses come within the tax net because you've got to register, then naturally the element of corruption will be reduced because a lot of these businesses don't pay any taxes. So that's one very salutary objective of the GST. The second salutary objective is that it allows for ease of doing business. And if you've got to pay only one tax in any trade, whether intrastate or interstate, then obviously you don't have to file multiple returns, you don't have to deal with multiple authorities, multiple officials of the state, and that also reduces levels of corruption and it makes business easy. So ease of doing business is the next objective of the GST. The third objective of the GST is it reduces the frequency of your having to comply with rules and regulations at various levels if there are different entities to which you have to make that compliance, right? So if you have an excise department, you have to comply with the excise department. If you have a service department, you know, for the service tax, you have to comply with the service department. So multiple agencies to that extent. So therefore, less hassle in filing returns to multiple authorities reduces, therefore, the tension in the mind of the businessman. And therefore, that's good for business. Broadly, these are the objectives of the GST. Now the question that we have to ask ourselves is, have these objectives been achieved? Personally, this is a tax which is in progress. In other words, as we learn from experience, the government of the day will actually tweak matters to ensure that, you know, all the three objectives that I'm talking about are achieved. Now at the moment, and see, if you look at an ideal GST should be one rate. right? At the most two rates. Because if you have different rates in goods and services, what's going to happen is that a businessman will find it very difficult to find out which rate applies to which product. And then he'll have to keep separate registers for that. Now let's just tell you what the rates in the present GST system are. There is of course the zero, the exemption. Several goods are exempted. There is the 0.25%. That is, rough diamonds are at the rate of 0.25% in GST. Then you have a 3% rate. 3% rate applies to gold. Then you have the 5% rate. Then you have the 12% rate. Then you have the 18% rate. Then you have the 28% rate. And over and above that, you have a cess, which can be imposed by the central government to make up for the loss of revenue in the states, because a lot of the manufacturing states would lose revenue. So therefore, the central government can impose cess at any point in time. So therefore, this is a hybrid GST. It's not a classic GST. And this will result in a lot of complications in our system. Now, if you look at any other country, most of the countries that have actually embraced the GST have not more than two rates. But of course, India is a quasi-federal structure, so states have their own responsibilities, their own sources of revenue, and the states don't want to give up those revenues. So this is therefore, instead of it being a two-rate tax, it's a multi-layered GST, which will create a lot of problems as we move forward. Now, having said that, in all other countries, it applies to all goods and services, the GST. Here, 40% of it is outside the GST system. Tobacco is outside the GST system. Air turbine fuel, for example, is outside the GST system. Liquor, completely outside the GST system. Electricity, completely outside the GST system. So though you have a multi-layered GST, you have 40% of the economy outside the GST system, where states will do what they want. The moment they feel that there is a loss of revenue somewhere, they will start imposing levies in areas where the GST doesn't apply. So how this system ultimately is going to work, one thing is sure, it's going to be a lawyer's paradise, because you and I are going to benefit enormously from it, because there are going to be any number of disputes that's going to arise. So that's the second point I wanted to make. The third point I want to make is that the Indian economy, 80 to 90% of it, is in the informal sector, right? You have the BD workers somewhere, you have glass, people who make glass somewhere, copper somewhere, traders in cloth somewhere. And they are all small businesses, small transporters who go across the state. And they are all unregistered. So let me just give you a small example. Let's say a trader in Chandni Chowk who trades in cloth. So how does trade in cloth take place in Chandni Chowk? I mean, just give you an example. The person will send his lot, maybe of one thaan, two thaan, four thaans, five thaans, to whosoever he wants to sell. And he will sell it on credit. And after weeks, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, even 6 months, he will get the money and some of the lot will be returned to him. And with the money that he gets, he makes another few thans and sells another few thans. So the money rolls over, right? Now his problem today is that the moment he sends those thans to the buyer, he has to pay tax. Now, a small trader has no capacity to pay tax in advance. He doesn't have the capital. So he has to then buy. Now, therefore, when the yarn happens, you know, he has to pay the tax the moment he forwards it. that person may after 2-3 months return some of the products, but he's already paid tax on it. So he doesn't know what to do. How will he adjust that? These are all very, very serious problems that small businesses are going to confront as we move forward. Now, the biggest problem with the GST is the following. A person who has a turnover of less than 20 lakhs doesn't have to register. Any businessman who has a turnover of less than 20 lakhs doesn't have to register at all. What does that mean? He can sell the product, not having to comply with this complicated GST regime. Now, the person who buys it from him, because he is the first purchaser, he has to pay the tax. The unregistered trader doesn't have to pay the tax. So the person who buys it has to pay the tax, and he cannot claim input credit for it. So what happens is, he says, and then he has to cut an invoice in his own name. He'll have to cut a self-invoice and pay the tax on it and then forward it to the next buyer. Now he says, why should I go through that hassle? And why should I have to pay the tax? If I were to buy it from a registered dealer, I will get the input credit and I can sell the product further. So why should I buy it from an unregistered dealer at all? And 80 to 90% of all businesses in India are small-scale dealers, medium and the small industry, which don't have a turnover of more than 20 lakhs. So now the registered dealers are saying, I won't buy from you. No. Which means what? Which means even those those who are not required to be registered will have to be registered. Because otherwise their business will stop. They'll have to register themselves. The moment they have to register themselves, they have to comply with all the requirements. And what are the requirements? They'll have to file 3 returns every month. That means 36 returns a year plus 1 annual return, 37 returns. Now the guy doesn't have a computer. He doesn't have a chartered accountant to advise him. So what will happen to him? Many of them are just small dealers who have no idea, whose levels of literacy are also minimal. So he can't function a computer. So he'll have to hire somebody. That fellow will charge him. Then he doesn't know the details of the taxation system because he's never come, for the last 60, 70 years, he's never paid tax. But the cloth merchants in Surat are agitating around strike for several days. They've been lathi charged also because they say, why do you, for 70 years, even in Chandni Chowk markets are closed, 70 years we haven't paid tax. What do you ask us to do? I have to pay 5% tax now. How do I do that? So this is the biggest issue that is now being, has to be dealt with, and the government doesn't know how to deal with it. But of course, the result is now these small little registered dealers are going to have to register if they want to survive in business. And naturally, they will have to survive in business. And what impact it will have on their livelihoods, because we're really talking about the common man, what impact it will have on their livelihoods is not yet known. But assuming, let's for a moment now assume that they actually register, right? So their costs will go up. If their costs will go up, ultimately when they sell the product will cost more. Ultimately, the common man who buys cloth will have to pay more. So, the argument of the government that because of the GST and the fact that the multi-layered tax may be there, but the taxes have reduced in some items, it will result in fall in prices, is a completely false premise. Remember, in a market mechanism, prices have nothing to do with tax. You may tax a commodity at 8%, but price of that commodity depends on demand and supply in the market. The other day, despite the monsoon, and every year monsoon, the vegetable prices sometimes come down. the price of tomatoes, and some of the ladies here would know, was 110 rupees. Right. Now, this is a market mechanism. It's nothing to do with taxes. So the whole propaganda that, look, GST is going to result in fall in prices is completely based on a completely wrong premise. And now they say that if, for example, you used to pay 15% tax earlier, let's assume service tax used to be 15%, it has come down to 12%. So they say that element of 3% you must pass on to the consumer. And if you don't pass it on to the consumer, then we'll prosecute you. Now the prices which he will sell, he cannot control, because that depends on demand and supply. And if the authorities and the taxman will be after him that you haven't passed on this 3% because your prices are more than the 3% benefit you got. So we'll prosecute you. That itself is a fear that most of these small businesses are worried about, that the taxman will be after them. So as I said, the one big issue is the small, the medium enterprises who do not have the capacity to register. Then the other big problem with the GST is that it has not done away with local taxes. Now I'll give you an example. Entertainment tax under the GST is 18%, right? Now, let's say cinema. You buy a ticket, if it's over 100 rupees for a cinema, the tax is 28%. If it's less than 100 rupees, it is 18%. Now in Tamil Nadu, what they have done is, because the local authorities can impose their own taxes, they have taxed all 100 rupee tickets and more at 30%, over and above the 28. And less than 100 rupees, at again 30%, over and above the 18. So people have to pay 58% more. 18 plus 30% and 28 plus 30%. In some other states, some other tweaking has taken place. So there is no uniformity also in this. For example, Maharashtra has now started imposing a road tax of 2% for every new vehicle that is registered, which was not there before. And so many of these local taxes which they are entitled, which are the municipal taxes, the entry tax and other things, will all be levied by the state government because they want to make more revenue. So then you are now saddled with several returns, as I told you, 37 returns annually, right? And then on top of that, you are saddled with local taxes within the system. And on top of that, the 40% which is outside the GST, you may be saddled with those taxes as well. So then what's then the rationale of the GST? As I told you, the three objectives that we were talking about. Will it do away with corruption? I doubt it very much. Because a person who cannot survive, and this is very simple, a person who cannot survive in the system will survive somehow. He will have a deal from where he starts to the end of the chain and say no invoice, and the deal will go through. I'll give you a small example of this court's order. This court ordered that every truck that comes to Delhi has to pay a tax, right? Environment tax. Now, any number of trucks come into Delhi, but if you look at the data on the number of trucks to Delhi and the number of trucks who pay that tax, there's a huge gap. Because the inspector on the border says, take it, give me this much of money, that's the end of the matter. Similar things will happen here. For those who have to survive, will survive. Right? The quality of corruption will be different, but the incident of corruption will be there and will be rampant. That's number one. Number two, reduction, as I said, ease of doing business. In the scenario that I have put before you, where is the question of ease of doing business? You don't even know where you stand. I'll give you another example. Logistics. Now the octroi has gone. Right. Now most of these people, most of these transporters used to do job work and give services. Now, all of the big dealers are saying, you first register before we allow you to give those services to us. Now they say, now how are they going to register? They don't even know the wherewithal to register. So all truck movement, I mean 50% of the truck movement on the borders has stopped because people don't know. The ideal, of course, is that, and this is what the government has said, that when a transporter carries goods across the border, he will have to have a, what is called an e-way bill. And the vendor, the sender, will have to give him an e-way bill, which he'll have to carry. The government says that by October 2017 will we have an e-way bill in place. We are not decided on the format yet. So there is no e-way bill. So now some ad hoc arrangements are being made. And you know what the problem is, that if business stops like this way, the next quarter in the economy is going to go down. And then systems, so it will take a long time for the system, like demonetization, it will take a long time for the system to be put in the right course. Then there are other very, very complicated issues of export. You want to export a product, as you know, under various schemes of exports, you used to get credit for importing the product, right? And then you do the value addition and you export it and there's an exemption. Now customs duty is, like, you cannot get credit anymore. So you've got to pay customs duty in advance. Now if you pay customs duty in advance and then you do the value addition and then you export that product, then you have to get a refund. You get a refund. Now in order to get a refund, you don't know when that refund is going to come. Right? So if that refund takes 2 months, 3 months, 5 months, 6 months, that is where corruption will start. Refund jaldi chahte ho, to itna do. Right? And then the other issue is of capital requirement. Because the person who doesn't get a refund and has to pay the customs duty and do the value addition and export the product, he will need that capital. So his capital cost will go up. And if his capital cost goes up, then his product may well not be competitive in the market. Well, the very purpose of giving you exemption to duty was to reduce your cost, give you exemption from customs duty so you do the value addition and export the product. These products are only meant for exports. But if you don't do that and you have to pay the customs duty, which is heavy in many cases, your capital cost will go up, you will not have any capital, or the cost of capital being high, you will be non-competitive in the market. So the impact of all that is yet to be seen. And there's a very interesting that's happened in the frozen meat business. In the frozen meat business, they have said that you will have to pay the tax beforehand to the government, the GST to the government. You buy the meat, you freeze it, and you pack it, and then you have to pay the tax. Now, there are people who will have to pay around 400 crores beforehand to the government. Now, this tax, incidentally, the moment you export the goods, will be refunded to you. But they need a capital requirement, some of the big players, of 100, 200, 300 crores to pay the tax upfront. So those people are saying to us, where are we going to get the money to pay that tax upfront? And the government regulation is that you will then refund it in a period of 7 days. Now, when do those 7 days start? There is no clarity on that issue as to when the 7 days start. Does it start from the day you have frozen the goods? Does it start from the day you have dispatched it to the customs barrier? Or does it start from the day actually the export takes place? If there is a delay in the exports, you are stuck with that investment because you can't get the refund. And then who knows if the refund is going to come in 7 days? Nothing, as you know, you've seen, we all lawyers know what happens with refunds. It takes months sometimes. So you invest 400 crores, borrow at high rates of interest, don't get your refund in time. What happens to your business model? And this applies only to cattle trade. It doesn't apply to all other meats. It doesn't apply to fish. It doesn't apply to all other frozen meats. It only applies to cattle. So that's another serious issue. So this broadly are the very complicated issues that we'll all have to be confronted with, as businesses will have to be confronted with as they move forward. So there's absolutely no clarity. Then the other problem is of classification. What happens today, for example, cosmetics is a luxury item. Now, if I go to my Chandni Chowk constituency in the Jhuggi Jhopri, the poorest of the poor ladies use cosmetics. Is that fair? So many of these items it makes no sense. If, for example, I'll give you a small example. You go to Haldiram and you pack stuff and you bring it home, you pay 5%. But if you eat at Haldiram, you pay 18 or 28%. For the same thing. So why will you eat? Why would you pay 28%? You just ask him to pack it. Now, if you have all packaged products are taxed at 5%. So if you buy biscuits, you're taxed at 5%. Right? If you buy atta, which everybody eats, it taxed at 5%. But if it is without packaging, it is not taxed. Right? Now, who sells atta or who buys atta which is not packaged today? And this is an everyday product. So it has enormous economic implications on business. It has enormous political implications. Because if the aam aadmi and the small and medium scale industry, the small man is impacted in this adverse way, it will have a political impact too. But it's a business in progress, it's a law in progress, it'll take time to sort of iron out all the creases. Even I am learning on a daily basis on the new implications of this tax. And I guess when I meet you next, I can tell you something more. Thank you.
Sir, just a second, sir. Would it help in making India a manufacturing hub or no, sir? Because that was one of the reasons that India is manufacturing.
This is all a myth. This is all a myth. What is a manufacturing hub? How did China become a manufacturing hub? China became a manufacturing hub because land had no price. The Chinese government gave land and infrastructure free to the industry who came from outside to invest. Right? Now the cost for manufacturing, the maximum cost is the price of land in this country. Right? That itself then, see, manufacturing depends on two things, price of land and price of capital. Both are almost the highest in India. The cost of capital, if you go and borrow from the bank, if you borrow from abroad, it is 2%. You borrow here, it's 14%. How will you be a manufacturing hub? This is just a bhashan ki baat hai, that we will be a manufacturing hub. And the kind of regimentation that can take place in the China can never take place here. You have labor laws, you have our wonderful courts. And so how will you be a manufacturing hub? These are all dreams that are being sold. If what we are saying is right, today our Indian economy, 59% is in the service sector. 59%, almost 60% of our economy is in the service sector. How can we even dream to be a kind of manufacturing hub? Right? We're just over 20% in the manufacturing sector. It's well nigh impossible. Now, yes, what is happening is, and this is really what is being sold, that they are saying in the high end of the sector, like mobile phones, not even mobile phones because the Chinese have taken them over now, but in the high end, in the aeronautical industry, you are having some deals, some agreements with big players in the West, in the, for example, manufacturing certain very esoteric items in the aviation industry. Well, that's not manufacturing. When I talk of manufacturing, it means footwear.
Yes.
It means clothes.
Food.
Right? Agricultural items. We are in a mess. As far as agriculture, let me tell you about agriculture. In agriculture, for example, if a kisan has a turnover of less than 20 lakhs, of course he doesn't have to. But that's quite agricultural income. If that very farmer were to have a little shop in the village, right? Or he sells milk. So he has a little shop and he sells milk. And he sells cow dung, for example. And his turnover is more than 20 lakhs a year, he has to be registered. So his income from agriculture will be added on to his non-agricultural activities. And if that income level is more than 20 lakhs, he'll have to register. Which farmer in India can register? These are all dreams. So these are very serious issues, and of course as we go along we'll understand them better. And of course you are the ones who will resolve them ultimately.
Any other question? Any other question, please? You want question? Please. Sushma,
what
want
about
one question, sir?
Apart from professional income of a lawyer, if he has a rental income or other sources of income, how that
you would have to pay GST. Of course you have to pay GST.
That is the whole amount, professional as well as in the, or it will be split into two parts.
No. I don't think it's going to be split.
That means you have to register
for GST.
You'll have to register.
Kumud, you want to ask questions? Yes.
So it was always one nation, one tax. So finally, what finally came out was a dual system of tax, which is now, in fact, followed by multiple system of tax. So this is the complexity, which, you know, that would have the effect on the construction or the real estate.
No. Real estate is outside the GST. See, what happens is if you sell a complete building today, no GST. But if it's a constructed building, that means it's not complete, then GST. And there there'll be input credit will not be there.
For advocates, if you can explain how the advocates should.
Oh, let me first understand it myself.
We will keep that how those are made 20 lakhs.
What could be the simplified version of it? Means how it could be simplified?
No, this is all. See, ultimately, the GST as it has emerged today is a political compromise. It's nothing to do with the GST. It's not a good thing. What do you mean? You have 5 taxes? I mean, what kind of GST is this? It's because the states pressurized, ki hum nahi manenge. Right now, this government wanted to tell the world, see, you've done something historic. So they wanted to actually show to the people and they are tom-tomming about it. But this is all a political compromise.
Torturing the common man.
No, not torturing. I will not say the torturing. We don't want to use extreme expressions.
Yes.
But the fact of the matter is that it's a very, very, ill thought out. It's a hybrid GST system.
Yes.
That's what it is.
So it could be
simplified. So what would have been the GST under the EPA regime?
Again, what I said in the beginning, I don't want to bring any politics in it.
But sir, like you said,
we had said there'd be 2 taxes, 15% and 18%. No more.
And what about the 80%
people
of the
agree for 15% tax, sir?
All right.
Most of the items are exempted, and then many of them are.
I told you about the exempted items. What are the exempted? 40% are, 30% are exempted.
That's why those would also be taxed under that 15% and 18% regime.
No harm.
No.
I say no harm. See, what ultimately it's input credit that people will get. But at least it will be a system. For example, take a chappal. One second. Please understand. I'll give you an example.
Question.
Take a chappal. If you go outside, I went the other day to buy a chappal. It cost me 2,000 rupees. Please sit down. Now, below 500 rupees, chappal is without tax. Now, who gets a chappal for less than 500 rupees? You tell me. You call it exempted. But it's not exempted for the ordinary man. Any leather chappal you buy or any other chappal you buy is more than 500 rupees. Now, somebody says, okay, look, you can't tax a Mercedes at the same rate as you tax a chappal. There's a fallacy in that argument. Because a Mercedes which sells for 50 lakhs, if you charge 15%, you imagine the amount that you will have to pay on it. And if you charge 15% on a chappal, the amount is much less. You don't go by the item, you go by the level of tax. Ultimately, it's time for, and of course, there should be the same exempted items would have been there even under the UPA regime. So the exemptions would not have made a difference. It's the multi-layered tax that makes all the difference. But say, in other words, I don't want to enter into any politics. That's why I didn't want to answer those questions. Because it's, I'm not here as a political person. You asked me to explain what the GST is today, and I tried to explain it to you, right? Without bringing any color of politics in it, right? This is what it is. But as I said, it is work in progress, right? I am sure if the government looks at some of these issues that I have talked about, they will take them into account and maybe do something about it. I'll give you another example. If you go to any shop now, aap kisi bhi dukaan pe chale jao, you will find that that shop sells goods which are taxed at 5%, sells goods which are taxed at 18%, and also sells goods which are taxed at 28%, right? Now, under the present law, has to keep 3 separate registers. This is the ease of doing business that we're talking about. He has to keep 3 separate registers. And then he has to file 3 separate returns on each of these items, which means 36 into 3 every month. Those fellows in Chandni Chowk are telling me our chartered accountant has jacked up his rates by 50%. He says, "Itna kaam bada diya aapne, main kyun kaam karunga?" My chartered accountant came to me, I said, "Mera to kaam utna ka utna hi hai." Theek hai na? Politics aa jayegi to kab ho jayega. So the point is, now what are people doing? You talk about corruption. What are people doing? Now people in one family are setting up 3 companies.
Yeah.
In the same shop. One owned by the father at 5%. One owned by the wife at 18%. And one owned by the son at 28%. So that they don't have to file those returns. And their turnover will be less than 75 lakhs. If it is more than 75 lakhs, they have to comply with all the law. This way the turnover, because they are separate companies. So point is, you don't, see, if you want to do ease of, if your objective is ease of doing business, you don't put systems in place which make people dishonest. This is precisely what we wanted to try and avoid. The whole purpose of the GST was to simplify law, the law, to make the GST a more, you know, easily compliable system without any hassles. But that has not been, unfortunately, not going to be achieved. And my biggest worry is the small and medium sector, the unregistered dealer, which is 80% of the backbone of the Indian economy is that. Ludhiana mein sab log, matlab ke jo kadhai wale log hain, unka sara kaam band ho gaya, kyunki wo job work karte hain, kadhai ka kaam karte hain, agle dealer ko dete hain, wo unregistered hai. To jo Ludhiana mein kharidna wala hosiery ka aadmi hai, wo kehta main aapse khareedunga hi nahi, kyunki mujhe to input credit milega hi nahi. Agar wo register karenge to aap sochiye unka halat kya hogi, unko maloom hai nahi, sadhan hi nahi hai.
रेंटल इनकम फ्रॉम प्रॉपर्टी 20 लाख से अगर ऊपर है जो 30% है उनको मिलता था इनकम टैक्स में रिबेट मेंटेनेंस के लिए, क्या इसमें अलाउड है?
अरे भैया आपने टैक्स कंसल्टेंट के पास मुझसे ये बातें, मैंने तो कभी रिबेट लिया नहीं, सो मुझे नहीं मालूम.
वन इंपॉर्टेंट अनाउंसमेंट सर. फ्रेंड्स, आई एम हैप्पी टू इन्फॉर्म यू दैट फ्राइडे ग्रुप हैव नाउ यूट्यूब इट्स ओन चैनल. सर इज गोइंग टू अनवील टुडे. वी आर ऑल वेरी हैप्पी. प्लीज सर, राहुल गेट अ लिंक ऑल्सो.
Thank you very much, sir. Vote of thanks will give Suri sir, please. Suri sir, please. One second. Sushma, please, 1 second.
Highest in the world? 28%.
Yes, sir.
I request only.
But it's more than the cess over and above that. You can make it even 50% on certain commodities.
I request Suri sir will give you vote of thanks.
Sir, before I thank Mr. Kapil Sibal, who is our respected senior, he was my president, I was his secretary. I think I must give compliments to Shishu first. This man religiously has conducted this Friday group, and this is how metamorphosis comes and evolution of lawyers come. Every time people are coming, and every time I'm finding that each listener and each speaker is trying to raise the bar, and that's what we should continue. Sir, we would like you to come more often, not only on the GST but so many things, because how to go for the quest of excellence, we want to learn it from you, sir. And thanks, you have come here and in a very simplified manner told us about all the complexities which are there, and it's made us wiser today. We are very grateful, sir, and very grateful for all the people who are here.
One second. Thank you very much, Markandeya sir, your most senior most person, Basant sir, sorry, retired judge sir, Basant this year. And Jaydeep Gupta, thank you very much, sir. We are very happy. All other friends, sir has to go at 4 o'clock. He has a serious commitment. So thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.